Join me today as we ponder, could the Star Wars sequel trilogy have been better had things gone a few different directions? This is the Geek Cabal channel. My name's Bobby, and we're going to be talking about the Star Wars sequel trilogy today and some ways that things could have gone differently and we could have had some better movies. Now, I do want to note that Jim and I have talked about doing some other videos because we have a franchise fixes segment where we talk about Star Wars. We're going to talk about, in more broad strokes, some things that could have been done differently or that could potentially still be done to try to salvage things. So that's gonna be a whole other thing. This is just some thoughts I've been having recently, related to some other videos we've released. And I just want to start off up front. I'm not gonna say something like, well, if you just scrap the whole thing, you know, and do the and just make the Thrawn trilogy, for instance. Now, yes, in my opinion, that would have led to a better outcome, but I don't mean that. I mean, like, let's say for a moment that, you know, you're sitting there, you're at Disney, you've been given this ultimatum by Kathleen Kennedy that things, in certain broad strokes, still basically have to happen the same way. So, what are some things you could have done differently? And I accept that this is purely a thought exercise, probably a pointless one, because, you know, I'm sure people are going to point out in the comments that, you know, it's too far gone to even consider anything like this. But anyway, we're going to plow ahead here a little bit. So I recently had a video about moral complexity in Star Wars, and I have to say that I do think it can function in Star Wars. And I saw a more recent video. Someone had a slightly different take. They were asking a different question, and they were talking about moral complexity versus gray morality. And I think that I think it's an important distinction. Whereas, like, moral complexity, and I hope I'm getting the two right from their description here and not conflating the two, but moral complexity is a morally complex situation. There can still be a right answer from a moral perspective, but that right answer might have consequences. And that kind of approach would make Star Wars interesting, because the Jedi are essentially paladins, to use like a D&D phrase, or possibly like warrior monks or clerics, however you want to look at it. But they are in service to a higher cause. And forcing them into a situation where there is a right answer from a moral standpoint, but that right answer is going to have a cost. Excuse me. You know, that makes for drama. That makes for potentially entertaining scenarios. You know, where you see, you know, is the Jedi actually going to stick with the right thing to do, knowing that it's going to have consequences? And so there's a what if I've pondered for a long time in the back of my mind that I'm probably going to do a separate video on. And I don't know what the right answer would be to this question. But like I said, I'm going to do a separate video on it. So then you have your moral gray area is where you have moral relativity, where there isn't necessarily a right answer from a moral perspective. And it's usually a contrived scenario, you know, where it's the trolley problem, essentially. And you can only go with a least bad scenario. And that can be interesting, you know, how someone who's trying, you know, to be a moral person would face that scenario. That can be interesting, but that takes a good writer, which is absent from Disney at the moment, as near as I can tell, except again for whoever wrote Andor. So, like with that in mind, and also this concept, I haven't really talked much about this, I don't believe. I know I definitely haven't done separate videos on it. Is this idea of, can Star Wars grow up? Can it be more than just the kids' fantasy? And number one, I think it can. I think it already is. Yes, the original trilogy is presented essentially as a fairy tale in space, but it's not like the moral lessons it's teaching don't apply to adults. You know, like, it's, yes, we live in a gray world, but there are things that are very clearly good and very clearly evil. So, where am I going with all this? Let's say that the sequel trilogy took a different track with things. Now, obviously, everything I'm about to say didn't really happen, and obviously, I would correct other things along the way. Like, I would have not had Han and Leia break up. At least not for the reason that they did. There could be good reasons for them to break up. What we got was stupid. So there's some minor things like that along the way, but I'm talking more big picture. And to combine all these things together, to also overcome the fact that one of the biggest slaps in the face of the sequel trilogy is that the actions of the heroes in the original trilogy ultimately don't matter. The First Order still exists. The Republic is stupid. And ultimately, it gets destroyed, and Palpatine still returns. So, nothing they did actually mattered in the grand scheme of things. And yeah, you can take some nihilistic approach to things like, well, nothing any of us does actually matter in a cosmic scale. And you're right, it doesn't in a cosmic scale. We don't live in a cosmic scale. We live in a human scale where our actions very much do matter. And again, that's the moral relativism claptrap. So, you know, I have no time for that crap. Not in the real world. Can make for interesting storytelling, but, you know, real world, not so much. It just allows awful behavior and excuses it. So, what do I mean here with Star Wars, though? Let's say that instead of, oh, the Republic disarmed. Now, you'd have to make the movie very differently, because you'd have to actually go into things with the Republic and the First Order, or we would need an earlier movie or something, because 30 years pass, so maybe the trilogy would have to be set earlier or something. But essentially, instead of, oh, the Republic disarmed, how about we find out that this idea, this idolization of the old Republic was for naught, you know, because we see the Republic in the prequel trilogy. We see that it is hopelessly corrupt. And while the Sith have played a role in that, Palpatine is the symptom. He's not the disease. You know, I mean, he becomes the disease, but he's only able to do what he does because so many other awful things have happened. And that's a result of the type of government they have and the way people have tried to, and the way people have manipulated it to their own ends. So, I don't find it surprising that they recreate the Republic, especially since they're going to use people who used to be Imperial senators and have it all just blow up in their face again. I don't actually find that far-fetched. But that's not really how the movie presents it. The movie presents it as, oh, everything's all hunky-dory until Starkiller Base blows them all up. I think that's a mistake. I think that they should have tried to go with the fact that, yeah, the First Order's out there, but part of the reason why they're able to do what they are is because the New Republic is just as corrupt as the old Republic. And this is where we get into the whole, like, we get a little bit more complexity, but we also get our heroes, not so much that their efforts were for naught, but that they're realizing maybe they didn't do enough, maybe their efforts were mistaken, and now they're more mature and they can see that, you know, we had this rose-colored glasses version of the Republic. It was flawed. That's how Sidious took it over. So now they have to fight to change it, to actually make it an institution worthy of their efforts, while at the same time dealing with the fact that there's still remnants of the Empire out there. And I think if you were to take the plot in that direction, you know, you get a little that satisfies your urge to talk about hero worship, only it's an institution here in this case. And you'll also get that still with Luke. You know, if that was handled better, you would have Luke rebuilding the Jedi Order while having to accept that its previous incarnation was flawed. You know, there's, you know, again, they were defeated for a reason. It's part of that is because they had become too self-righteous. They could not see the flaws in their system. You know, they couldn't see that they were on the verge of destruction already by slipping into this, not so much apathy, like personalized apathy, not generalized apathy. Like, the Jedi cared about the universe. They cared about Coruscant. They cared about the general population and maintaining peace. They didn't care about people, the individual person. And part of that is this complex stuff in the EU that kind of explained it. And of all things, the Acolyte actually touches on this a bit. There used to be multiple Jedi temples, not just the temple on Coruscant. So the Jedi lived closer to the people, but they consolidated everything onto Coruscant, which meant that, you know, the little people slipped through the cracks. And over enough time, that's what allows people like Palpatine to take over, you know, because the Jedi are no longer paying attention to the little people. It's, I mentioned it before, it's the broken windows philosophy as far as combating crime. Broken windows and graffiti doesn't sound like it's big crimes, because they're not. But allowing those is the step before allowing something greater. And eventually you're talking, you know, drug use and violence and all kinds of other things, which leads to gang warfare and corruption among the police and, you know, your judicial system and your government. It's all one step after another, where at any point people could have stepped in and stopped it, but they didn't. And it's the same concept here. You know, not paying attention to the problems of the little people eventually leads to only really caring about the problems of the big people. And that's how you miss the fact that the Sith have returned and didn't die out 1,000 years ago. So having them actually tackle these things and have to realizing that, you know, not all your problems can be solved. You know, and again, I hate to quote Admiral Holdo here, or Leia, I don't know. You don't solve all your problems by hopping into an X-Wing and blowing things up. Okay, now, for whatever it's worth, Poe was actually doing the correct thing at that point, and Purple-Haired Lady was the one way in the wrong, but the general sentiment, you know, there's adult solutions to things. Yes, there is the point where it's hopping in your X-Wing and blowing things up, but at a certain point, it involves things beyond that. And again, like, I think some parts of the movies tried to maybe do this, but they just failed spectacularly. And so you would need something more, you know, you need something like this. And this would lead to a more adult movie, you know. And we've seen that we can do this with Andor, because Andor is our prototype here. You know, Andor shows that Star Wars can have these things, because Andor asks very serious questions like, is it okay, you know, if you're trying to overthrow an oppressive regime as entrenched and powerful as the Empire is, you know, where do you draw the line as to your actions? Is anything justified? And if so, what makes you any different than them? You know, have you lost the moral high ground? Does it matter if you have the moral high ground? You know, and it asks these questions well, whereas the Acolytes just kind of like, eh, good, evil, what the hell's the difference? And that's why it sucks, among many other reasons. Whereas Andor, you know, it you have characters I think it's Luthen is the name, Stellan Skarsgård's character, who acknowledges that what he is doing is evil. that he's performing evil acts. He's killing people. People are being killed because of him. But he believes, he hopes, that it's worth it for the greater good of bringing down the empire. And he hopes that he's somewhat morally justified in doing these things. And you can tell he gets it in that speech that he gives towards the end of the show, where, you know, the subtext that is he's pleading for justification. You know, he knows what he's doing is morally reprehensible as far as the deaths and everything, but he doesn't see any other way to do it, because he knows protesting sure as hell isn't going to work against the empire. And so, you know, it asks, these are complex philosophical questions here that have real world ramifications for those of you who don't pay attention to global affairs. And so, like, the sequel trilogy could have gone down that road. It could have asked, you know, what are people like Leia and Han willing to do in the face of a clear threat when their own government is also a problem? You know, and again, then there it'd be not because if anyone has ill intentions, except maybe the former Imperial senators. You know, it'd be someone like Mon Mothma, who would be portrayed as like an idealist. And Leia sitting there trying to tell her, like, no, you don't understand, like, you were playing politics on Coruscant, like, I was in the trenches, like, I understand what it really takes. You have high-minded ideals, which are lovely, but we live in the real world. Like, that's never going to fly, and trying to go up against that and having Leia deal with things like realizing that she fought for this ideal that will never work. You know, it will always lead to rampant corruption and everything else. And having to finally come to grips with the fact that, no, we need something else. And it doesn't make bringing down the empire a mistake, or anything like that, or pointless. That had to be done for anything else to succeed. But now realizing that plan A isn't going to work either, you know, and having to actually sit down and come up with a plan B, you know, that's being an adult. That's, you know, that's what it's all about. And so, and you could, if you really had to go with Han and Leia breaking up, then it would be the fact that Han is trying to tell Leia this. And because he, you know, as the scoundrel, he can see what the angles are, and he can see that things aren't going to work out, and she just won't believe him, and she just refuses to give up, and she's spending all of her time doing this. He sees their son slipping away or something, you know, work all that into it. Again, I'm not a writer. Some of this, you know, just me spinning my yarn here, but, you know, so I think if they would have come at it from that angle, and you would have Snoke, I would have stuck with him. I wouldn't have brought back Palpatine. You'd have him angling to basically become the Chancellor again, you know, the same similar way to Palpatine, except he's just going to be brazen about it and like, well, I'm just going to get a corrupt bunch of corrupt people to vote for me. And if that doesn't work out well, then there's always the military option. And so you could have made a much better, more adult movie that shows that sometimes the fairy tale ending just isn't going to happen, and you've got to actually, you know, really work for something better. And I just, you know, like I said, it's just kind of a what if. It's very broad strokes. I'd really have to sit down and sketch out how else things would go. But I think if you would have done that, I think people could have lived with, oh, so they still haven't actually fixed things in 30 years. If you show that, well, there's real problems. And, you know, if those problems are the kind that wouldn't have been immediately self-evident, and that they're the kind of problems that it would take real personal grit to admit that you were wrong, that the solution that you fought for isn't going to work, and now you have to do something else. And there's going to be people on your own side who are going to be like, no, we fought and died for this. This is what we're doing. And who aren't going to be able to accept that it's not going to work. And again, you know, you also factor in Luke trying to recreate the Jedi and trying to figure out what they did wrong. And maybe he's made some mistakes in that time. And maybe that's where the villain really comes from. Not Kylo Ren, but some other student that he failed somehow. And, you know, now he's got to figure out, can I bring them back, or do I have to accept that maybe some people can't be brought back? You know, that'll be his test ultimately. And, you know, you do things like that. You would have had a solid trilogy. You know, it would have been a natural outgrowth from where things were. You know, I'd dump the dumb aspects like Operation Cinder, but you could have done things so much better if they just would have tried. You know, if they just would have taken what was and made logical extensions of it. They could have still had their politicking, their interpersonal conflict, the fact that everything didn't wind up all hunky-dory for the heroes. You could have had all that if you had a better, you know, base plan to work from. You know, to show that, yeah, you know, sometimes things don't work out. Sometimes you got to go with plan B or C. And, you know, you could have made for a more interesting movie. Anyway, that's just my thoughts on the matter. So let me know what you guys think down in the comments. Like, share, subscribe, all that fun stuff. Sharing and commenting are the things that really help us the most grow the channel. We always appreciate that. And other than that, you know, be on the lookout for more Star Wars content, because I'm sure it's coming. But other than that, folks, just remember, the Force will be with you always.